Testing, testing. Testing, testing, testing.
A bulletin, get it out. We need to go over the things that are going on today. It's going to be kind of a busy day. We're going to have communion today. That's going to be at the end of the service. What I got to thinking about the fact that, and it's hard for me to make this adjustment, we're streaming everything. And I really don't think that that's really super appropriate that we stream the Lord's Supper. I mean, this is an intimate time for people that are here. So we're going to move that to the end of the service. And also a couple of weeks ago, we streamed the business meeting. I think that was kind of dumb. I think about the people that are sitting home watching that, you know, they couldn't have got much out of that. So same thing, whenever we have a business meeting, we're gonna put that at the end of the service and Chris is gonna stop streaming at that point. So after the service this morning then, two things are going to happen. We are going to have the Lord's Supper. So it's really not after the service, but after the stream. Then we're also going to have a business meeting. I mentioned, for those of you who were here Wednesday night, we've got some financial issues. And I want to talk to you about that after the service this morning. It's kind of just an informational type thing. You know, it's not like a formal business meeting. So I promise I won't keep you so long that you can't beat the Methodists into the restaurants, all right? Wow. I know it's already passed, but if you weren't here in the first service, you really missed. I mean, that series is just so good. And it's not accidental that we're watching. In fact, the lesson this morning was about the state. And here we are, you know, just a couple of days before the election. So it was extremely timely, extremely good. In fact, the presentation was, I thought, brilliant. And so you really need to get in on those. It's just once a month, and you only have to come 15 minutes early. So just keep that in mind next month. All right, not this coming weekend, but the weekend after that, we have the small church conference. I have four of you shared with me that you're planning to go, and that's great that we got advance notice that you're planning to come. If you did not get registered, you're still welcome to come. If you would let me know, that would be beneficial. They're kind of doing things like we do a lot of things last minute. So they're going to send me the booklets Monday, and so they have to have some idea how many is coming. So if you want to come, just let me know. Yeah, it's Friday night, just a fellowship time Friday night, and then most of the classes will be on Saturday, and then it will end at 3 o'clock Saturday. In fact, if they're not done at 3 o'clock, we can just leave. Yes?
How long is that on Friday night?
Friday night, I think, is like from 7 to 9, probably.
So are we canceling?
Oh, yeah. We'll have to talk about that. Okay. Yeah. I forgot all about that. I'd thought of it a week or so ago, but then forgot again. So, yeah, we'll have to talk about that. All right, workday is the 21st. We are going to do that. We have some work that needs to be done to the we call it the White House over here. Nobody's in there right now, so it's a good time to get some stuff done. And I think we'll just try to do the things that need to be done on workday. So if you can come help, that'd be great. The 22nd is Family Day this month. You know the routine there. Make a mental note on the 25th. That's Wednesday night, no Bible study. We began that a few years back to give people time to prepare for usually the big family gatherings. One of the things that I wish was happening is that Family Day would be that weekend, the same as Thanksgiving, so we could get rid of the leftovers. But or reruns, however you want to call it.
We can always move it for 1 month.
Yeah, we might do that next year, but now it's kind of short. Because if you mess with the schedule, you have to let people know a long time in advance because they just have trouble processing change. All right, since we're, again, a little bit rushed today, let's go on with things. It's time for a song, hymn number 63. Stand if you're able as Bruce comes to lead us. 1 day. We thank you for this grace, Lord, of being able to gather this morning, for the freedoms that we still enjoy, Lord, to come together without fear of threat or harassment. But Lord, we're mainly grateful for you, and the reason that we have gathered is to worship you. And I pray that you'd help us this morning to block out, Lord, all the cares and distractions of this life, Lord, that we might focus on you today, that we might seek to bring you honor and glory by all that we do. And Lord, as always, we pray if there's someone here that doesn't know Christ, that today might be their new birthday, and we'll thank you for it. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. All right, you may be seated. Penny March time.
43, in your hymnals, 43.
Kids this morning, but that's a good sign, isn't it, when the kids are bringing their offerings for the children's, what are we calling that again?
Penny March.
Penny March, yeah. It's one of them mornings, I tell you. Well, this is it's a windy morning out there, isn't it? I was telling a couple of ladies this morning that I had a full head of hair when I left house this morning. So it was even windier out there where Jim was, as you can imagine. Well, we're glad that you're here this morning. Take a quick look this morning at the offering report. We trust that you always are mindful of what's going on so that you kind of have an idea of what the needs of the church are. We had a little better offering, but I do have to caution you and let you know that we are running a little bit behind, actually about $300 or $400, maybe more, in our average for the month, for the year. So I trust that you will keep that in mind and be praying about that. Would you do that? And the Lord will bless you for it. We do thank the Lord for God's faithfulness and the faithful people here at our church that have always been used of God in that particular respect. And we just continue to thank Him for that and praise His name for all that He's getting accomplished through this work here in Kokomo. Also, take a look at the missionary of the week is Benji Lokius. So hope you'll remember to pray for him, serving the Lord in the Philippines. And we have other missionaries in the Philippines as well, and we have other missionaries throughout the world. So keep them in prayer as well. And then we have a whole new list of birthdays and anniversaries. Well, we don't have a list of anniversaries. Just Tim and Janine bit the dust in November. But anyway, those are the birthdays. Wish those folks a happy birthday this morning. Have a number of things going on this morning, so I don't want to take a whole lot of time. I want to share with you just a thought this morning from Matthew chapter 6, verses 19 and 20, and where it says that we are to store up for ourselves treasures in heaven. Store up for ourselves, yourselves, he says. Now, the important part of that is what comes after that. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. I want to talk to you for just a moment this morning about chasing rainbows. At the deepest part of every one of our being this morning, there lies a longing, a kind of a hope, a dream, something that's more important to us than anything else. And whatever that is that we treasure most, we will tend to build our lives upon that. Whether it's our job, our wealth, our standing in the community, our physical appearance, or something else, we will go to great lengths to gain and maintain what we perceive is our treasure. And I know that money and wealth and physical appearance are particularly dazzling treasures that, as someone has said, hypnotize a lot of people into chasing after those false promises and empty security that those things are perceived to give. And sadly, much of what we treasure is like that rainbow in the midst. You know, some treasures are gone in just an instant. Sometimes we've all marveled at a beautiful rainbow, but it isn't very long before it starts to fade. And you say, oh, I hope it stays long enough for me to get home and show my wife or my husband, you know, because this is just a spectacular thing, you know. But then by the time you get home or whatever it is, it's gone. And that's the way it is. Some treasures are gone in an instant, and others, like our health, we treasure our health, they slip away over a lifetime. But there's only one treasure that really lasts forever, and that's Jesus. And Jesus wants to be the treasure of our hearts, folks. He wants to be the unrivaled master that we serve wholeheartedly. And the way to be free from those chasing those worldly treasures and those worldly pursuits, of course, is worshiping Jesus Christ. In worship, we treasure the infinite value of Jesus who gave his life for us. In worship, we delight in the goodness and the mercy of God. We set our hearts on the beauty of our Savior who loved us, and when we were quite unlovable, when you think about it. When our hearts treasure Jesus through prayer and meditation and song and scripture, we are reminded of what a truly priceless gift he is to us. We make an investment that will last forever. So the question we ask ourselves as we receive our tithes and offerings this morning is this: what is my treasure? What is the treasure of my heart? Are we just chasing those rainbows that's going to one day fade away? Or are we chasing after and pursuing after a relationship with Jesus Christ? Because that's really ultimately the only kind of a thing that really endures and lasts and gives the hope and the sense of security that we all crave. So as the men come this morning, we encourage you this morning to be faithful in stewardship. God will bless you for it. And we thank those who have been faithfully standing behind the work of the Lord here at Victory. And we pray that others will get on board and trust God for what God can do through them as well. Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for Jesus. We pray, Father, this morning that you will bless now this offering as it's received and all that's given, Lord, that will go out to strengthen the work here through our mission outreach, through our community outreach, in any way, Lord, that Christ will be exalted and lifted up. We pray that this will be the end. We ask it in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen.
Bibles, turn to 572. 572. Let's stand together and the junior church can be dismissed at this time. 572.
Open your Bibles this morning to John chapter 19. We're going to take as our text verses 28 through 37. John chapter 19, 28 through 37. After this, Jesus, knowing that all things were now accomplished, that the scripture might be fulfilled, saith, I thirst. Now there was set a vessel full of vinegar, and they filled a sponge with vinegar and put it upon hyssop, and they put it to his mouth. When Jesus therefore had received the vinegar, he said, It is finished, and he bowed his head and gave up the ghost. The Jews therefore, because it was the preparation that these bodies should not remain upon the cross on the Sabbath day, for that Sabbath day was a high day, besought Pilate that their legs might be broken and that they might be taken away. Then came the soldiers and brake the legs of the first and of the other which was crucified with him. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was dead already, they brake not his legs. But one of the soldiers with a spear pierced his side, and forthwith came there out blood and water. And he that saw it bare record, and his record is true, and he knoweth that he saith true, that ye might believe. For these things were done, that the scripture should be fulfilled, a bone of him shall not be broken. And again, another scripture saith, they shall look on him whom they pierced. Let's pray once again. Lord, we confess this morning that we need your grace. We need your grace this morning that we might be attentive to you, that we might be attentive to your word, and Lord, that we would not just be hearers of it, that we might be doers of it. And so again, as we prayed earlier, Lord, help us to block out, Lord, all of the cares of this life, all the distractions, Lord, to open our ears, our minds, and our hearts, Lord, to receive the truth of your word. And Lord, to receive it not in the sense of just saying, yeah, I believe that, but Lord, in the sense of submitting to whatever it might require from us. Lord, again, as always, if there's someone here that doesn't know Jesus in a saving way, Lord, I pray that you'd help them to see their condition. And even more than that, that they would see the solution provided by the Lord Jesus Christ and be saved. And we'll thank you for what you do in us and through us. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Romans the 8th chapter, verse 1, is a precious verse. It reads, "There is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit." And by the way, that last part is descriptive, not a sense of condition. Condemnation means damnatory sentence. To a believer, this should be one of the most precious verses in the entire Bible. There is therefore now no condemnation. None. An old preacher who was preaching on a village green in England had lived on the American prairies. He had a fascination for this individual's ears. He told of a prairie fire. He described the way that the Indians saved their wigwams from the blaze by setting fire to the dry grass adjoining the settlement. Their saying was, "The fire cannot come where the fire has already been." Now, that is why this verse and the text that we're looking at is so important. You see, judgment cannot fall where judgment has already fallen. That's why the scripture says there is therefore now, present tense, there is therefore now no condemnation. The reality is believers stand safe evermore because of the cross. We can never come into condemnation. The believer is in God's safety zone. Now, the text that we're studying this morning is God burning the grass. He is pouring out the fire of his wrath on the Son so that the fire of his wrath does not come to those who believe in Jesus. The Lord Jesus Christ takes the judgment, takes the wrath of God for us so that it will not fall upon us. Again, Romans 8, 1, "There is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus." Those are precious words, my friend, no condemnation. In that, we find the grounds for our hope. The Old Testament prophet proclaimed in Ezekiel 18:4, "Behold, all souls are mine. As the soul of the Father, so also the soul of the Son is mine. The soul that sinneth, it shall die." Death is more than just a passing away of this life. It means separation, and in the Bible it means separation from God. There are two kinds of death. Physical death is a separation of the body and spirit. Spiritual death is the separation of the soul from life or God himself. And that lasts for those, the unrepentant, forever in hell. Jesus died that death for us. Jesus died so that we might never experience eternal death. And our text this morning is a record of the death of Jesus Christ for our sins. And by the way, the Bible is a historical book. I love it. I mean, even, you know, some parts of it we don't really crazy about reading. I admit, when you get to all those so-and-so begat, so-and-so begat, so-and-so, I kind of skim over that. Some of you might judge me for that. However, those passages are important because they prove the verity, the truthfulness of the Word of God, the historical aspect of God's Word. They're important. We have in Scripture this morning that we're going to look at the actual historical recording of the death of Jesus Christ. It's not a myth. It's not something that people make up to cope with life. It actually happened. There was actually a Savior who stepped out of eternity and took on the form of a man and actually came, actually lived a perfect life, died on a cross, not for his sin, but for ours. Amen. And it's recorded in the Word of God. Now, we're going to look this morning at five facets of Christ's death from our text. First of all, it was no accident. Secondly, it was purposeful. Thirdly, it was not without suffering. Fourthly, it was sure. And then lastly, it was prophetic. First of all, consider that the death of Jesus Christ was no accident. Verse 30, when Jesus therefore had received the vinegar, he said, "It is finished," and he bowed his head and gave up the ghost. He bowed his head. He bowed his head and he gave up the ghost. The actual death, again, is recorded by John, and it's described by one phrase found in verse 30, and bowing his head, he gave up the ghost, or literally his spirit. The phrase suggests strongly that the death of our Lord was no accident, but that he freely and voluntarily gave up his life. No one took his life from him, he gave it. In fact, he told us that he was going to do that. Back in John chapter 10, verse 18, no man taketh it from me, but I lay it down of myself. I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it again. Jesus Christ willingly gave his life for us. Now, what do you say? That's nice. That's a nicety. It's infinitely more than that. In John chapter 15, verse 13, we read, greater love has no man than this, than a man lay down his life for his friends. 1 John 3:16, hereby we perceive the love of God, because he laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for the brethren. You see, at the proper time in history, the Lord Jesus Christ, at the exact timing of God, laid down his life. It was not taken from him, but rather he gave it. This was a great and most pronounced demonstration of his love for us. Secondly, it was purposeful. Look at the first part of verse 30. When Jesus therefore had received the vinegar, he said, "It is finished." Again, there were seven times that Jesus spoke on the cross. This is one of those. Before he dismissed his spirit, he spoke three words of deep significance. "It is finished." Now, what was the Lord speaking of when he uttered these words? He couldn't have been speaking of his death. He's still alive, and he gives up his own life. So that's not what he is speaking of here. He voluntarily dismisses his spirit. He must have been speaking of something else. And that is exactly the truth here. Jesus Christ, when he said, "It is finished," was speaking of the work of redemption for us. That is, Christ is paying for our sin. And he's not, folks, he's not putting a down payment here on our sin. He's not giving a partial payment for our sin. When he said, "It is finished," he's talking about full, paid in full, finished. You can't add anything to it. Payment for our sin. Christ satisfied God's justice to the fullest by dying for all of the sins, for past, present, and future, of all those who place their faith in Jesus Christ. Now, the good news is those sins can never be punished again because that would violate God's justice. Again, the fire can't come where the fire's already been. God cannot condemn us for what he condemned Christ for, that sin that we committed. So what Christ is speaking of here, again, is the work of redemption, the pain in full for our sins. It is finished. The work of redemption is complete, brought to an end. You can't add anything to it. Put out of your mind that, yeah, I placed my faith in Jesus. Now I got to be good from here on out. No, when Jesus said it is finished, that means it is finished. And if we try to add anything to it, we ruin it. There's nothing left to do that has not already been done. Hendrickson noted, as Jesus saw the entire work of redemption, both active and passive obedience, fulfilling and the law and bearing its curse, had been brought to completion. Erdemann notes it is finished, imitated, as John tells us, a divine consciousness that his earthly ministry was ended, that redemption was complete. For those who are burdened by the guilt of sin, nothing remains to be done but to accept him as the Lamb of God. For those who have been stricken by the power of sin, there is eternal life if they will look in trust to the uplifted Christ. Such is the issue of faith in the divine Son of God. There's nothing left for you to do to be saved but to cast yourself on God's grace and believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. You don't have to keep the law because guess what? Christ kept it for you. You don't have to be perfect because Christ lived a perfect life for your sake. You don't have to die for your sins because Christ died for your sins. Nothing is left. Nothing is left. Can I say it again? Nothing is left. You know, when Jesus said, it is finished, that's exactly what he meant. You don't have to add anything to it. All right, thirdly, it was not without suffering. Verse 19, well, not right. Get the right verse here. Then the Jews, therefore, because it was the preparation that the body should not remain upon the cross on the Sabbath day, for that Sabbath day was a high day, besought Pilate that their legs might be broken, that they might be taken away. Then came the soldiers and brake the legs of the first and of the other, which was crucified with him. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was dead already, they brake not his legs. Christ's death for us was not without suffering. Now, one of John's main themes throughout the book of John is that Jesus Christ was God. In fact, that's stressed again and again and again. So it might be easy for us to lose the sight of the fact that Jesus Christ was not only God, but he was man. He was fully man. And so he would have suffered on the cross in the same way that you and I would have suffered if we had went through that. Part of that suffering was burning thirst. Pink writes in his book, The Seven Sayings of the Savior on the Cross, while here on the earth, the Lord Jesus gave full proof of his deity. He spoke with divine wisdom. He acted in divine holiness. He exhibited divine power, and he displayed divine love. He read men's minds, moved men's hearts, compelled men's wills. When he was pleased to exert his power, all nature was subject to his bidding. A word from him, and disease fled. A storm was stilled, and the devil left him. The dead was raised to life. So truly was he God manifest in the flesh that he could say, he that hath seen me hath seen the Father. He goes on to say, though, so too, while he tabernacled among men, the Lord gave full proof of his humanity, sinless humanity. He entered the world as a babe wrapped in swaddling clothes. As a child, we're told that he increased in wisdom and stature. As a boy, we find him asking questions. As a man, he was wearied in body. He was hungered. He slept. He rejoiced. He groaned. And here in our text, he cried, "I thirst." That evidenced his humanity because God does not thirst. The angels do not thirst. Neither shall we in glory thirst. They shall hunger no more, neither thirst anymore. Jesus was God, but he was also man. He suffered for us as man. In our place, he suffered thirst that we might have the living waters and thirst no more. I say hallelujah. All right, then fourthly, it was sure. Verse 30. When Jesus therefore had received the vinegar, he said, "It is finished," and he bowed his head and gave up the ghost. He died, folks. He died at that point. Verse 33, but when they, that is the executioners, came to Jesus and saw that he was dead already, they break not his legs. Now, let me assure you that these men would know. This was their profession. They were experts at causing and determining death. So when they came to Jesus, they saw that he was dead. And by the way, this again, it's not that when they put Jesus in the grave, he simply swooned and then he came, he revived himself. No, he was dead. All right, there, and this is part and proof of it. So Jesus was God, also a man. We have here the tradition spoken of that the Sabbath was coming. The tradition was that they didn't want any condemned criminals on the cross. They hastened that death by breaking the legs, because on the cross, part of the death was by asphyxiation. Because every time the person on the cross had to breathe, they had to lift themselves with their legs. So when they broke the legs, they couldn't do that anymore. So that's the reason that they broke the legs. But Jesus was already dead. And again, these men would know, but just in case, they take a spear and stab him in the side. Verse 34, but one of the soldiers with a spear pierced his side, and forthwith came there out blood and water. All right, fifthly, it was prophetic. Verse 34 through 37. We already just read verse 34. And after he saw it, he bare record, and his record is true, and he knoweth that he saith is true, that you might believe. For these things were done that the scripture should be fulfilled. A bone of him shall not be broken. And again, another scripture saith, they shall look on him whom they pierced. The prophecy of verse 36 found Psalm 34, verse 20. He keepeth all his bones, not one of them is broken. And the prophecy of verse 37 is Psalm 22, verse 16. For dogs have compassed me, the assembly of the wicked have enclosed me, they pierced my hands and my feet. And in Zechariah 12, 10, and I will pour upon the house of David, upon the inhabitants of Jerusalem, the spirit of grace and supplication, and they shall look upon me whom they have pierced. Again, the prophecy of verse 28, Psalm 22, verse 15, my strength is dried up like a potsherd, and my tongue cleaveth to my jaws, and thou hast brought me into the dust of death. Again, proving Jesus' death was no accident. It was not designed and carried out by men, but it was designed and carried out in the plan, eternal plan of God. It was purposeful. It was not without suffering. It was sure, and it was prophetic. And my last point was, it was for you. All that Christ did was for your sake. And you can have the assurance of forgiveness of sins and eternal life, not by being good, folks. That's a lot of people's idea about salvation. Well, when I get to God, he's going to judge my life, and he's going to look at the bad things, and he's going to look at the good things, and if the good things outweigh the bad things, then he's going to give me eternal life. That assumes that God will grade on a curve, but he doesn't. The standard is perfection. If you want to get to heaven by your efforts, you have to be absolutely 100% perfect. And in case you haven't figured it out, you're not. And you can't. Even if from this point on, you lived a perfect life, which you can't, but let's just say that you could. What are you going to do about past guilt? You can't do anything about it. The good news is Jesus did. And he pronounced that work was completely finished. All you have to do is look and live. Place your faith in Christ for who he said he was, that is God incarnate, and what he has done. This is the two main themes of John's gospel. He came, lived a perfect life, died for sin, not his because he was perfect, but for you and I, so that we, by placing our faith in him, could have full and complete forgiveness of sins. I've had, I'm a little bit of a jokester and sometimes ornery, and sometimes I get carried away. Go ahead and say amen. On several occasions, when I worked at transportation, I'd have people tell me, you're a Christian and you do something like that. And my reply was not to be defensive about it, but my reply is, yeah, that's why I need a Savior. And guess what? So do you. Jesus died for you. Is the question this morning that you need to contemplate, is his finished work put down on your account? That's what imputed righteousness is. It's not that you're righteous, but God takes Christ's righteousness and puts it on your life. If not, why not? I think 2 Corinthians 5:21 is the best deal that's ever been offered mankind. For he hath made him, that is Jesus Christ, to be sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. He wants to take your sin, put it on Jesus. Jesus died for it. He wants to take Christ's righteous life and clothe you with it. Is he your Savior? Let's pray. Lord, we rejoice this morning in all that you have done for us. Lord, the reality is you are so amazing. Your plan of salvation is so amazing. And Lord, there's one sense that's pretty simple. If we'll turn our back to sin and self-lordship and turn to you in faith and accept what you've done for us in Christ, we will be saved. And my sincere prayer, Lord, is that there's someone here this morning or someone that's listening via our live stream that has not placed their faith in Christ, that they would do that today, before it's everlasting too late. Now, before I finish that prayer, let me ask you a question this morning. Have you trusted Christ? Can you say, yep, I am saved because I have placed my faith in Christ? Not because of me, but because of what he has done. If that's you this morning, it's a testimony of his grace and mercy. Hold your hand up high. I'm saved, I know it. God bless you. Brother Tully would say, what a wonderful sight. If you could not or should not have raised your hand, you can take care of it this morning where you're seated. If you will pray from your heart, Just something simple. Lord Jesus, I acknowledge I'm a sinner. I know I'm worthy of hell. I pray that you forgive me. I receive what Christ has done for me as my own. And again, the prayer, as long as you get the basics, it doesn't matter the exact wording of the prayer. As long as you're putting your faith in Christ. If you are doing that this morning and you want to let me know, I'm not going to come to you, embarrass you or anything, but I'll rejoice with you. You say, I'm trusting Christ this morning. Just slip your hand up and down. Is there one? God bless you. Anyone else this morning? I am trusting Christ as my Lord and Savior. For those of you who did that this morning, can I say to you, it is finished. If you're truly placing your faith in Christ, it's a done deal. You are saved as somebody that's walked with the Lord 30 years. You're as saved as you can get because Christ says so. It's finished. All you have to do is trust what he's done for you. Lord, we rejoice this morning in the gospel message. Rejoice in the decision that was made this morning. And Lord, now we pray that you would help that person to take the further steps in growing in grace and knowledge and following you in obedience. Lord, that you might be able to bless their lives on the way to that trip to heaven. And we'll thank you for the fruits of it, in Christ's name. Amen. I think we will we'll hold off on a invitation song. And we'll go ahead with communion. Go ahead and cut this stream.